afternoon, everybody. This is Peter. This is our October 28th weekly radio address. I hope everyone's doing well. I'm going to be your guide for the next hour and a half. For the first 45 minutes, I'm going to go through questions and address some new points, simple points, actually. And then for the last 45 minutes, we'll have Jacques and Roxanne on. We haven't had them on in a while. They've been traveling quite a bit, so we can get an update from them to see what's the what. They seem to be doing very well, and the interest continues to grow, which is fantastic. Let's see here. The first thing I wanted to point out was this program that we have called Poodle, which is done for translations. I've mentioned it before. It's a very simple program. Lucas, some of you might know, has been doing a great deal of back-end work with this program, trying to make it very fluid for the orientation guide or the films or anything, really, to be input into this program, and then people from all over can come and translate in the interface fairly fluidly. And I want to basically talk about that very quickly. If anyone out there, especially we need English proofreaders, for one, according to Lucas, if you want to help out with this in any capacity, whether you want to help proofread, you want to input, or you want to help translate, it's really appreciated. And I think the easiest way to do it is to go to the linguistic subteam, which you can find in the forum under Projects Communications Team. And by the way, yes, this is a new addition to our communications team. It is a back-end team, so it isn't going to have as much of a forefront as the education subteam, the activism subteam, and the lecture circuit subteam, which I'll be talking about more soon. The lecture circuit subteam, and I'm sorry to jump around here, really has to do with the chapters more than anything else. This is something that I'm going to try and get going with packages for universities where people that are within a particular chapter in a particular area, naturally many of you have universities, and attempt to use the universities to your advantage to talk, at least initially. Obviously, renting out places is a great idea, and we're going to have packages for that too. But the universities tend to be fairly fairly open-minded, and they tend not to be as expensive as normal rentals, and hopefully they don't cost anything whatsoever. You just put on a free event at your local university. But back to Poodle. Anyone that can help out with this, please do so. Yeah, G-Man is someone also that was commented to me to contact in regard to help in this regard. And Lucas, his main point to me was they need native proofreaders to come through some of this material. So that's that for technical stuff. One thing I wanted to throw out there that came to my attention from a good friend, I'm always a sucker for flash mobs and anything that's kind of grassroots and social. There is a website called hugyourbank.net, hugyourbank.net. And in the spirit of everything that's been going on with the banks, as many of you might know, there was actually a massive protest in Chicago against essentially the banking establishment, a little more specific in regard to certain points, but nevertheless, this is an amazing precedent. I hope everyone out there sees this. I was the Wall Street Bank protest, which occurred, I believe, almost a year ago. That was fascinating as well. I know I'm ignorant, but I've never seen a point in time where people are actually mad at the banks on this level. So anyway, back to this website, though. What they're doing is they're creating materials that they're going to distribute as sort of what they're calling a Christmas flash mob, and they're going to go to banks, and they're going to pass out relevant materials that have to do with the fractional reserve lending practice and all the various shenanigans that we've talked about, almost limitless, on this show and in my materials, and get the public aware, even more so aware, of what's happening. So I'm just throwing that out there for anyone that has an interest and want to join in with these flash mobs. It's a great grassroots idea. Hugyourbank.net. Apart from that, I wanted to comment on an article I just recently read at Politico.com, which is a fairly decent reporting organization. And the article, if you want to punch it up, is entitled Bernanke's Trillion-Dollar Decision. And if you're in the United States, this is a really interesting thing you want to watch for. The article essentially summarizes the fact that the Fed is prepared to start contraction. And if you've read the orientation guide, you know that the two lines that have to be walked by the Federal Reserve or any central bank as far as management has to do with the expansion and contraction of the money supply in the most carefully controlled way. And as has been also denoted in that guide, you can't have a balanced and even playing field when it comes to the expansion and contraction of the money supply. So, we had the bubble blow up with the housing market. We had things compounded and problems with the credit default swaps. We had an over-leveraged society, real over-leveraged to the hilt with a debt, which we still do. As I've said before, if the government really cared about resolving the economic issue in the most efficient way, they would be giving people money, not institutions. But in other words, they would start removing debt from the individual. That would be the most beneficial thing you can do to increase purchasing power and hence stimulate the economy. But we're dealing with cartels, and they're not going to. The last thing they care about is the people. But anyway, back to this article. It talks about the fact that they have to start pulling $1 trillion out of the U.S. economy. This is basically the switch. When they start hiking the interest rates and they start contracting and they start making it more difficult to get loans, even though it hasn't been that easy now due to many reasons, but nevertheless, they've been pushing liquidity from the Fed's position, even though some of the commercial banks have been restricting loan output because of the risk tolerance that they have been forced into. But this is an interesting point in time when this starts to happen. I want everyone to pay attention to this when it does, because this idea that the economy is getting better, if they do start pulling money, which they have to do because of inflationary reasons, then it's just going to get that much worse. There's really nothing that can make this type of move actually fluid and beneficial. Granted, that $1 trillion that was injected into the system, it's actually more than that, but we'll give them the benefit of the doubt, has been compounded by the fractional reserve lending practice. So there's a lot more money that's been created on top of that money. So when they do pull out that initial amount, which I'm sure it's an arbitrary amount that they're referencing here, it's going to have a pretty interesting effect. Even though it's not going to be, you know, like nothing ever happened because of the money that's actually been created. So anyway, I'm not going to harp on that. I just think it's a good thing to read about that. And as a rubbernecker, I can't wait to see when they start doing this, to see the fireworks. Because while production might be increasing, while there might be a general increase in GDP, and unemployment is still moving high, layoffs are still occurring. And once again, if the people don't have the purchasing power to do anything, it doesn't matter how supposedly healthy the economy is becoming. That's the catch-22. And a lot more I could say on that, but I'm going to jump into your questions instead. Excuse me. Let's see here. All right. Let's see. Some of these are good for Jacques. I'm going to try and prepare. Yeah, I'm going to keep that one for Jacques. Okay. Some of these are pretty long-winded. So let me see if I can read. Peter, I have one problem with the notion of arriving at decisions. I agree that there are many questions where the decision to make is straightforward and clear to everyone, like your bridge example, in parentheses, I gave a bridge example. Anyway, I'm going to keep going. Decisions are the product of the information you have, but there are situations in which two different sources are giving you different information, or where it is not obvious if advantages or disadvantages of a technology will have more weight. Personally, So shouldn't we agree that decisions being arrived at does not mean one person making decisions for all people, but rather a democratic way? For instance, we could say most decisions are clear to everyone, but some aren't, so you can vote on who makes the decisions, or we could establish a direct democracy by means of technology. Should we agree that decisions being arrived at means a democracy in which freedom of information and a population interested in the best for everyone allow a peaceful decision-making process? I want to hope that whoever wrote this did read the orientation guide when we talk about decision-making processes. The one thing that you state that concerns me is where you state that, where'd it go? Yes, decisions being arrived at does not mean one person making the decisions for all people. No. Not at all. In fact, the process really has to do with computerized association systems. In other words, artificial intelligence. The decision-making processes is a logical unfolding. Our decision-making processes, when we decide anything, is based on the tool set of information that we have, and we apply logic, and it unfolds naturally. We're all scientists in that way. In fact, I've been trying to use that metaphor a lot. Everyone is a scientist. Doesn't matter how deeply religious someone is. They use science in their everyday life for evaluation as this cause and effect type of relationship. When you go to buy a car, you look at obvious ramifications that are relevant. You don't just take someone's word for it per se. Or as a better example, as far as decision-making, and I apologize for this slight tangent, most people have a general understanding of the way an automobile works. If you didn't, then if your car breaks down and you look at the back and you see a flat tire, if you had no comprehension of what that meant, then you would have no idea what to do. Well, when most people, for example, their car doesn't start, they don't go back to the back tire and to look at the tires because they have enough information to know that the engine is what has a relationship to the car actually starting, generally speaking. So that's what I mean by the logical processes. So the conflict that you bring up, which of course is a good one, when we reach decision points, excuse me, when we reach decisions, let me clarify that. When we reach angles that have disjunct positions, meaning that there's a dichotomy, obviously there would have to be a decision-making process, especially in the transition, to get us from point A to point B. But in the future, I don't think that's going to be as much of a big deal as people think. You know, there's a lot of opinions out there. There's a lot of obsession with choice and freedom. It's almost arbitrary in the sense that people want to have all these choices, yet they don't even realize the pointlessness of the choices because there is an optimized way. There's always an optimized way. It's just finding and revealing and applying those elements that will create that optimization. And of course, that optimization is ongoing, which means all of our information is always somewhat incomplete. So, that being made, I think it's very important to realize that our decision-making processes and what we describe with the Venus Project and the resource-based economy is based on computerized systems invariably in the end, which has a natural gravitation. If you're following Ray Kurzweil and singularity, which I'm pretty sold on, at least in the general realm of it. I'm very much aware of the exponential increase. Human interface with machines is going to maximize tremendously. So it's not just going to be people sitting around, you know, claiming that their information is more accurate against another party that claims that their information is more accurate. The decision-making process will become unified through machines because these machines will be able to process associations faster than we can in time. And they already can in certain ways now. I'm not talking about science fiction hypotheticals here. We have to be concerned with what we see now. Even if we didn't have this exponential increase in computational ability and power and sensory systems, even if we didn't have that, even just by what we know today is enough to put us on the right track as far as applying technology, applying the scientific method to arriving at decisions in the most optimized way we can. It takes a very intelligent and informed system to be able to do that. And again, I don't want to go into all the details of that because it is in the orientation guide quite clearly. What I would say otherwise, though, is that the notion of arriving at decisions is really the concern. You have to have the variables there to allow you to make a proper decision. Decision-making processes today tend not to have those variables. In fact, it gets, again, very opinionated and it gets very abstract. And people want to believe that their ideas are correct just because they have those ideas without any feedback from the environment whatsoever. So these conflicts will arise, but they'll be easily resolved once we get our emotional aspect out of the way. This is really the biggest issue, is our emotional conflicts with things that we believe. You know, the greatest scientists are the ones that can work their whole life on something, and after 40 years, someone comes along and finds out that everything that they worked on was actually wrong, and that scientist would be happy to be proven wrong. But if you think about the emotional ramification of that, it would be, you know, for many people, it would be just a heartbreak to know that everything you've worked on for your whole life hasn't amounted to something and was on the wrong track. But that is a general reality that happens all the time. I'm sure we will look back at things that we think we've arrived at correctly today, such as treatment of cancer, and see in maybe 50, 60 years, actually probably sooner than that, how barbaric and idiotic these ideas actually were. So I think I've gone about four or five different tangents there in regard to your initial question. The decision-making process will not be done by humans in the sense that it's just a bunch of people sitting around. They will be aided with tools, those tools being computers, which can process much more information than we can. I'm trying to think of an actual example that would be a little more clear. It comes down to the design of society. If you look at society like an airplane, and you look at how to streamline everything, all attributes based on available information, then the parameters become self-evident. There is a physics aspect to building an airplane, just like in an abstraction, there's a physics aspect to building a society. Human beings have certain needs. You have to compensate for those needs as far as food, shelter, air, and everything else, and you have to compare those to resources. And it really just comes down to the value systems of the people, to be extraneous, to be exasperated. Eventually, through time, people are going to have to find a homogeneous basis. They have to come together with a general worldview, or we're just doomed. And that's really what we've lost entirely at this point. So anyway, I'm going to stop my tangents on that one. I hope I answered your question. Let me go on to number two. One second. Okay. If all resources are essentially to be considered communal property and the common heritage of all people collectively, I am curious as to how this notion extends to the idea of self-ownership. Since the Zeitgeist movement does not espouse belief in private property ownership by individuals, I would like to know how the concept would be applied to people themselves, their persons, and their intellectual constructs as individual resources. Do individuals, in fact, own themselves? If they do, doesn't self-ownership preclude access to the individual by all other people, just the same as it would any other resource? What is the difference in this regard between an individual precluding access to his or herself as a resource to all other people and, say, the same person precluding equal access to land or technology or any other resource under that dominion? Okay, I'm going to stop right there. There's a second half to this question, which I think is unrelated. Okay, self-ownership. Well, that's an interesting abstraction. I've never actually thought about that. I would have to say that individual organisms inherently have a self-contained element to them. We're all somewhat scarce. And if I understand your question correctly, I would say that self-ownership is not even really a viable concept. People have a certain degree of autonomy, whether you believe in free will or not. People are moving around, making decisions that seem novel. And therefore, they're unique individuals that have ideas, and they can share those ideas with other people. And I think that's really what it comes down to, are the ideas that you're talking about. There's no ownership issue with the individual. If an individual has ideas, yes, they should be shared. That's how things grow. Obviously, no one's forced into sharing anything. But, that's really how things grow in society. People share ideas, people build upon those ideas, and that's how society essentially moves forward in a cooperative sense. And that's what makes, as an aside, what we're advocating so much more powerful, because once our system of limitation is removed, the monetary system, patents, and all the things that restrict the sharing of knowledge, people will be able to move forward very, very quickly with ideas once they start sharing them cataclysmic how fast certain things can be devised and improved without the limitations of the system we have now, which is based on self-interest and individual narrow self-interest. So I hope I sort of answer your question. Let me read the second part of your question. To evaluate further, I might construct a thought experiment. Let's say an individual devises a cure for cancer. Would that knowledge be communal property or the property of the person that devised it? Wouldn't just the mere existence of the knowledge give that person tremendous differential advantage, even the absence of money and hence dominion over others? Well, I think there's two points that you're making to this. First of all, you would hope that in the value systems that will be culminated, when people come up with things that are socially beneficial or even personally beneficial, they would like to share that with their fellow human being. That's the idea. There's really no point in restricting if it isn't for money. As far as your second point, even in the absence of money, will they have dominion over others? Well, I suppose you could come up with a sick idea where someone could flaunt their cure for cancer and hoard it to themselves out of some strange neuroses. But what's the gain in that? I mean, anything's possible with distortions in the human mind, especially in our current culture. But I don't see that as being an issue. I think that the society will have such tremendous appreciation for people that do things like that there will be a lure for people to want to help society. And, they would be recognized as individuals in part, but they would also have a higher understanding to realize that most likely their work is building upon the work of others as well. As the old Newton saying, I've accomplished what I have because I've stood on the shoulders of giants. All knowledge is emergent in that sense and cumulative. in a way that adds to the unifying capacity as well. Everything that I'm saying has been a product of culmination, intellectual culmination, through education, therefore other people. So the symbiosis of information becomes quite clear when you think about it that way. So I hope I understand your question. The issue of self-ownership in regards to the simple abstraction of it doesn't mean anything to me. And as far as people's ideas, I think that they will be naturally motivated to share socially beneficial ideas. Otherwise, what's the point? And no, I don't think they will have dominion over others. In any type of circumstance like that, wouldn't last very long. The monetary system enables that to such a powerful level that once that's removed, I see I can't imagine the reasoning behind ill motivations like that. Not to say that they wouldn't exist on some level. There's still neuroses and ego, and in the transition, we're going to have that problem. But in a larger scheme, if you just follow the train of thought, it's easy to see how humans can come out of this muck, this way that we treat each other and the way that we think about our lives and our ideas and the ego and the ownership and the reward mechanism and everything else. Anyway, number three. Have you ever heard of Alexander technique? And then they give a description of it. It helps prevent, the way I see it, I'm reading this question. Peter, the way I see it, the Alexander technique would be of major help in spreading the vitally important information provided by the Zeitgeist Movement and the Venus Project. It could help people with giving talks to the public and press in various information forefronts. I will soon finish my studies and become a qualified Alexander teacher. My idea is to urge through a website or speaking up at Alexander conferences, Alexander teachers around the world to step out and volunteer to help the most dedicated Zeitgeist Movement, Venus Project-minded people. Well, that's very interesting. I've never actually thought about that. I am aware of the Alexander technique, yes. That was very popular when I was in school. There is a sensitive aspect to it that, I don't practice Alexander technique. I have in the past. Yeah, I certainly recommend it. But it's something that I'm not quite sure how you see the connection between that and the movement and the Venus Project. I could see the general positive aspect of it, you know. There's a balance there. But socially speaking, it's not really a social issue in its most direct application. But I encourage to do whatever you can to bring people together. I'm not quite sure what else to say about that. But anyway, number four. In your last show, you talked about communicating the message of the Zeitgeist Movement through mainstream music and films in order to reach more people. Is it possible to create something that is acceptable to the mainstream, commercially viable, and yet retains the integrity of the message we wish to communicate? Isn't it a paradox to communicate a message that is anti-establishment through the establishment mainstream? Well, yes. What's the old adage of being in bed with the devil? You know, people, unfortunately, the mainstream is still very powerful, and I actually try to avoid the mainstream at all costs, but there is a place for it. If you can get important information that would be considered counterculture, if you will, or counter-establishment into the mainstream, and it gains a momentum in the mainstream, then regardless of the medium, you can make a very powerful effect. I think Michael Moore has been able to strategically organize his films in a way that they've come into a slot in the mainstream, but the mainstream has become accustomed now due to his films to expect, you know, almost expect corruption and expect all the things that he talks about. So anyway, the mainstream is what it is. To get things in the mainstream is important. I avoid the mainstream as best I can, but none of my films have been picked up by mainstream distributors, even though there's been offers. I try to stay away from the complexity of it, and it's all money-minded people, so naturally, there's always going to be a compromise there. In regard to, people that are already in the mainstream, that would be fantastic if they were able to step forward and talk about these issues. We do need, say, a celebrity presence or even a political presence, if that was even feasible, if there are actually people. There's only two or three people in Congress I could even think about that would be open to these ideas. And I guess you could call that mainstream. So anyway, I'll stop belaboring that. In the end, yes, I think it's a paradox, but you have to do what you have to do. People watch the mainstream, and that's really the point. So getting anything there is hopefully would be helpful, even though it's like walking against a brick wall. because of the conditioning. Okay, number four, five. Peter, it is my concern that bickering and backbiting within the movement, specifically on the website's forum, will lead to a decreased involvement of those who would otherwise be motivated, and the appearance of instability to those that are unaware of our ideals, goals, and our means to those goals. What would you have to say to those that give in to their ego and disagree for the sake of being disagreeable? What would you say to those that are more concerned with being right than growing, both as an individual and as part of the movement? Well, you make a very good point. First, I would say in the forum is that we have over 30,000 members. I don't know how many of them are actually active. But the forum growth, based on the number of people joining, the users, has been very positive. In fact, I've seen a slight increase recently. And there's a lot of great people posting as well. Unfortunately, we have a tendency, I know I do as well, to want to be reminded of the negatives. So when I tend to scour the forum, the things that jump out at me are the people that are complaining, naturally. That's always the case. There's an old Bill Hicks interview where he talked about being censored on mainstream television because the Christian Coalition, I believe, called in and reported all of his material to the heads of whatever network it was. And he made a great point saying that, you know, most people, when they take in information, they tend to absorb it in a passive sense, and they tend to usually in agreement or just in observation, and they don't act upon it in the sense that they don't act upon it in the same degree that those people that have a problem. In other words, it's always the slim minority that has the ability to make a tremendous amount of noise and to disturb things. If someone really wants to complain, just one person, they have the ability to make a lot more noise than you would ever imagine, particularly on a forum. So we have a lot of people out there that do give in, they do have obvious ego issues. I've been belligerently challenged on the forum. I just ignore it. You know, what else are you going to do? And I suggest all of you that are on the forum, just those that have nothing better to do than complain, well, just ignore it. You're going to be dealing with this for the rest of your life, most likely, because unfortunately there's a lot of people out there that gain their own personal satisfaction, feelings of grandeur from constantly complaining. And that's just an unfortunate reality we have at this stage. Cynicism gets coupled with some form of depth or something. I know a lot of people with that type of mentality. Anyway, so again, there's plenty of people doing great stuff on the forum, talking about legitimate things and moving in a positive sense. And those that just want to keep bickering, I just ignore them, and I would say to them that, why are you on the forum? If you have nothing else to do than complain, why are you there? There's other places you can go and complain and bash these ideas if that's your disposition. So, number six. Okay, this is a long one. I tried to break this one down. Let me see if I can read this and make sense of it with my edits. Peter, I have read and heard that people are thinking how the Zeitgeist movement should be in the direction of integrating a resource-based economy within the current system. I project that this line of thinking is very unreasonable and that any such endeavors would ultimately lead to failure and disappointment. This type of thinking is very discouraging to me because I feel that the very first section of my summary is where most of the direction should be focused. I've had to skip a section because it's too long. I'll continue. Why? Because the more people that are aware of how we are all being forced to live and being forced into living a life of slavery, of endless debt, war, poverty, etc., people will be more inclined to shun this immoral and cancerous system and furthermore come to the conclusion that they could no longer contribute to it and comply with it. The more people that can arrive at that same conclusion, the better tendency that this horrible system will basically implode on itself and self-destruct. And when that happens, people are also informed enough of the alternatives and the benefits within, the vast majority of people will hopefully embrace what the Zeitgeist Movement and the Venus Project is advocating. Yes, well, first of all, nowhere in my talk or Jacques' talk has it all come down to trying to apply the system within the system. It's always been a social transformation. Other people have taken it upon themselves to build websites and to advocate basically the creation of a city system within our current system. And I would agree with you that while that's a great example, and that we do advocate a test city, we do advocate a theme city, if you will, to show these ideas, but it isn't a city. It isn't a city in the sense of people just move in there like a commune. I think that is, in fact, rather dangerous. I would agree with you. Getting the first city up in some form is very important, but the social therapy is much more important as far as I'm concerned. And I should probably make a note to bring that up to Jacques when he comes on, because it's something that keeps coming back over and over and over again. Everyone seems to believe that if you took the culture we have today and dropped them into a nice city, a nice self-sustaining city with renewable energies and everything else, that somehow it would magically work. It wouldn't. It wouldn't work at all. It was back to my analogy from last radio show of taking a culture out of the indigenous wilderness and dropping them in the middle of New York City and expecting them just to adapt immediately. It's going to take a lot of transitioning to get people to understand the new value systems and why they're relevant. And again, this isn't Mr. Fresco making things up in a creative sense. It's based on an empirical train of thought. So I don't want to go off on that tangent too far, but what I will say is that the Zeitgeist Media Project is going to be very pivotal to this and other projects of that nature. We need people out there making media to influence culture. And I hope everyone out there is doing that. I'm seeing a lot of great new movies come up. Anyone out there now can get a $500 HD camera and you know, download a torrent of any video editing software and can make a movie. And everyone's doing it. I think everybody should continue to do it. The saturation of media is truly amazing, certainly like nothing we've ever seen before. The days of, you know, the elitist artist, there's few groups that could survive and afford to make albums. Those days are long gone. The days of the super groups are probably long gone. Now it's a massive pool of media. And I think it's a double-edged sword. There's good and bad attributes to it as far as saturation. But things do come to the surface that have value. So, point being, regarding the question, I believe that the city system is probably a second step. Or actually, it has to go simultaneously. We have to change, we have to influence culture at the same time and build a test city to show that science actually works. And a lot more can be said on that, but I don't want to spend too much time on that. But I will make a note for Jacques. Hold on 1 second. In fact, that's a point that I should probably find a way to articulate in writing, maybe make an article out of that so everyone really understands this issue. Maybe I can append the orientation. Though I think actually that point is made in the orientation, but it seems to come up quite a bit. Number 7, what do you think would happen in a resource-based economy to drug abuse, not just illicit street drugs, but also cigarettes? If you might want to elaborate more, what about caffeine and other products like that? I believe there'll be no reason for established regulatory institutions that are subject to heavy lobbying from corporations, i.e. the FDA, to downplay or falsify information about the danger of certain chemicals and drugs and things that are in food. That's the first step. Once money is out of the picture, people will have a much more clear understanding of what the dangers of certain things actually are. I still think there's a great deal of ignorance. Think about how long it took for the obvious reality of cigarettes and its relationship to all sorts of physiological problems to really come forward in the mainstream. I think if people were handed a pack of European cigarettes today, a little kid, where it actually says right on the pack, smoking can kill you, which I always love that. I always love looking at the packs of cigarettes in Europe, and I'm just still blown away that they don't have that type of severity in the United States. But nevertheless, eventually, good sense will prevail. And, you know, if someone wants to smoke cigarettes and they're aware of the problems, well, I don't know what to say to that. Just as it's not condoned in restaurants today, I don't really see how it could be condoned in the future. Why support unhealthy, debilitating practices? So in time, during the transition, I think all drugs should be legalized. I think the criminal conflicts that arise from criminalization, in other words, the amount of people in jail because of drugs is nuts. I think 60% of the American prison population are nonviolent drug offenders. These people are sick. They're not criminals. So on that level, people will have the freedom to do what they need to, but there will be a social pressure to move away from all of those things. Caffeine, things like that. Again, in moderation, those things are probably somewhat okay. It just comes down to the science, and nutritionists and people of that sort can take it upon themselves to really do the research without any limitation to understand what really promotes the well-being of the human organism. That's what it comes down to. I think in the future, to carry your point even further, in the future people will not have we won't have fast food. There'll be no reason for it. Why would you want to eat something that has just the worst conglomerate of toxins, essentially, as in most McDonald's, with the least amount of nutritional value? These are novelty items at this stage, mainly because of poor people, because it's based on demographic. So it's also based on a cultural neuroses of speed. Those are two aspects of it. People have derailed their nutrition for the sake of speed. Not to say that good food has to take a long time to cook, but nevertheless, things that don't help the person would naturally be phased out of the system. All the money-making schemes that are essentially pollutants, that are there to get you addicted so you can keep coming back and spend money, as a basic example, those are gone. So it really just comes down to the benefit. Number 8. Hi, Peter. I have shown Zeitgeist Addendum to people I know and want to show them the first film that you made. I'm not sure if I should. I remember you saying that there's a director's cut of the first film. Do you think I should show them the original film, or do you think I should wait for you to release the director's cut? It really just depends. The director's cut or not, it really just depends on who that person is. Addendum is a more balanced portrayal of general ideas, and it's less susceptible to projected sensationalism and a lot of the strange things that the first film has triggered. I'm always amazed when I meet people that talk about the first film because the way it was constructed was as an experiment, essentially, with a lot of different directions happening simultaneously. It wasn't supposed to be the kind of thing where you reach a certain point and it's universally acknowledged, and that's the point of the film. Now, there's at least 10 or 15 layers of points I could go into on that one. But nevertheless, it really comes down to the person. If you're dealing with somebody that has a religious inclination, well, then don't bother them with the first film. There's other things that you could show them. And I think ultimately, when it comes to the movement, the orientation guide, as bare bones and simplistic as it is, I think still does a very good job. So I think that's what I would show. But if you have people that are younger, that are more open-minded, and they're not quick to jump on the bandwagon of opinion, or that have heavily locked-in dispositions in regard to their worldview, then I think Zeitgeist One serves a legitimate role in shaking up that belief system. All change comes from a certain form of instability, so you have to kind of keep—you have to engage people on an emotional level, and that's really the intent of that first film. Yeah. And that's basically all the questions I have, and I'm going to bring on Jock and Roxanne here in a couple of minutes. There was one more question that, if you were following along, that I'm actually going to ask Jock when he comes on. That has to do with how we determine if a belief or a value is relevant. And since I have a few minutes before they pop in, what I would say to that is essentially, what is the utility of that belief? When someone has a belief that they're going to go to a special place when they die, if someone really believes that, what does that do? And is it pro or negative in regard to their functionality? If someone believes that they can walk on the wall, well, they really can't do that, can they? If someone believes that they look at a wall and it's obviously white and you can get the spectrum analysis machine, I'm not sure what that would be called, and you can analyze it and see that it falls into the white category in the electromagnetic spectrum, the light spectrum, excuse me, then it's basically white and it's provable by science. But someone could say, well, it's my opinion that it's blue. It's my belief that it's blue. Obviously, that's an extreme example, but people unfortunately have very similar angles like that, where they reject all information coming from the external world. So, you know, values and beliefs have to be relevant to the society, and the relevance should be defined by positive effects. Culture lag theory is an interesting one. I think Stuart Chase was the first to really talk about this in my reading. Essentially, technology has created a paradigm where we're in culture lag. I would say we're always in culture lag, but right now is an amazing point in time because of this exponential increase in science and technologies and information sharing, just information in general that's at our fingertips is unbelievable. Nothing like we've ever seen 10 years ago. You can go on the internet and get anything, seemingly. That point being denoted, I think that culture lag, when it comes to technology, you're going to have people that have value systems that are just going to become increasingly more outdated because information is developing, information comes forward, new information arises that removes and makes void old information, and what you're left with are people that have emotional attachments to the information they know because of identity purposes, and therefore they are in culture lag, and they can't take the emotional, they can't overcome their emotionality to redefine their terms. I'm not being very clear on that. What I mean essentially is that the environment is changing, and if the human being doesn't change to fit that environment, then it's going to be left behind, so to speak. And that's really what it comes down to. How you assess that on a very typical clinical level, it's not that simple. It's not that simple, and obviously there's a bit of gray throughout all the subjects like this. So my values, when I look at my values and beliefs, I would say that I base them almost exclusively on scientific principles, meaning that I won't believe anything just because it's anecdotal. I have to see something that's actually tangible. I want to see things that show a concrete resonance, if you will, from the environment. I want to see feedback. I want to see evidence. That simple. So that's a little bit different than values, but we can talk about that. In fact, I think I see Jack and Roxanne, so let me bring them on. Okay, here we go. Hello?
Hey, Peter.
Hey.
Hi, how are you, Peter?
All right, good to talk to you guys.
You
I'm
too.
Doing well, thank you. And how are you guys?
Very well.
Good. Well, before we begin, you guys have been traveling quite a bit in El Salvador and Mexico, correct? I haven't gotten too much feedback on that. Why don't you tell us what happened and how all that went?
First we were in Copenhagen and then London.
Oh, right, of course.
For a week. And then we went to Mexico for a conference where Jacques got awarded some international design award and spoke to about 900, mostly students, in the design
right.
field.
Wow.
And then we went to San Salvador where we had a two-day seminar, actually ended up being more like 3-day, on the Venus Project to the university students, but mostly a lot of the professors and some of the politicians in the area and people who had special invitations. And that went very, very well.
Well, that's great. Yeah, I just realized that we haven't spoken on the show for quite a while since you did go to Europe.
Right.
So you've done a great deal of traveling since then. So you did a 3-day, how in-depth was the 3-day conference, if you will? I imagine that's a long time for you guys to talk about these issues.
Well, it was, but we had a translator after
okay.
every few sentences, so it was kind of half the time that
oh, wow.
we spoke. But it was about 2.5 hours each day, and then some private meetings.
Great. Well, that's wonderful.
So it did. It went real well.
Do you know if that was recorded in any capacity?
Well, there was a small TV show that did an interview, too, and I believe that they recorded some of it.
Okay.
But I haven't seen it yet.
Right. Well, I'm sure people would love to see that. Any and all new media, of course, is always welcomed and quickly absorbed.
Right. You usually see it before we do, so.
Right. Well, usually other people see it before I do. I just happen to finally stumble upon it.
But we're going to try and get it all up in one place from our trip.
Yeah, that would be great. And and generally speaking, I think you should maybe get a small camera and try to document everything that you're doing. I know that there's a large audience that would certainly, you know, again, would really like to see pretty much everything that goes on. So just a thought.
It's a good idea.
Well, that's great. Well, congratulations on the award, Jock. That's very interesting. What was the award again? I'm sorry.
For design, the year's design award from one of the most interesting and the best designs, architectural.
And was that based on a specific thing that you did for them, or was it a general award?
General award.
Okay. Well, that's great. Okay. Let's see here.
It was put on by A. DeZino that is, I think, just about, it's a very good design magazine throughout Mexico. And they do awards each year, and Jack got one of them this year.
Good. Okay, well, we have a bunch of questions from people.
Fire away.
Yes. And the first one is a deep one for you, Jacques, and I was attempting to give an answer to it right before you came on. It has to do with values and beliefs and the relevance, and essentially how you would go about evaluating the relevance of values and beliefs and their relationships.
If it attains to survivability, and not only that, growth of a culture, it would be implicit in the system. If all the values that people had were related to improving relationships, the environment that people live in, and the environment that's external, the oceans, the air, protection, and cleaning up the mess we made in the oceans, the atmosphere, that's what I mean by relevant.
Right.
Relevant is any form of education that advances society.
Very good. Very good. And the issue of education, you've mentioned in the past, isn't just about learning specific fields. It's about learning values as well. I believe that's an important thing that no one talks about in modern education.
Relate to one another and disagree without getting angry.
Right.
How to permit the differences. Also, how to behave. In other words, children behave in ways against different types of races and people and sexual preference. In the future, all that will be dealt with in school so that you don't have to take it on as a problem that comes later. In other words, how to relate to different people of different values, of different sexual preferences, different fields of endeavor. They will learn how to talk to one another. When an artist meets a structural engineer, they will say, I know nothing or little about that field. I wonder if you can explain the invention you're working on in lay terms so that I can follow that. They will learn how to speak to other people of different disciplines. And there'll be cross-discipline language so that architects can talk to environmentalists. Environmentalists can talk to anthropologists. And the behavioral field is a very large portion of education, human behavior. Our values, and the values would be based upon, as I said before, sustainability. When they use the word today, sustainability, I wonder who they're talking about. The banks, the investment field. I'm talking about sustainability of the earth and all the people on it. I'm not talking about some preferential sustainability.
Right.
So when they use the term sustainability, I would suggest that you say, what do you mean by it, Dad?
Yes, very good point. Very good point. In regard to science, there's a bunch of shotgun questions here. How do you define science, Jacques?
How do I define what?
Science.
Science.
Science, the methodology of determining the next most probable. That's one description.
Gotcha.
Another is a careful inquiry into the nature of the phenomena you're observing. And not to project your own desires or meaning or belief systems into your experiment. To run an experiment means to investigate the nature of the phenomena you're observing by adding nothing, subtracting nothing, and merely reporting on the events you observe.
Very good, very good. And as you pointed out, technology is increasing quite rapidly, and these types of decision-making processes can eventually be moved to computers, because obviously human beings have an emotional hang-up because we tend to project like crazy. And would you comment on the development of arriving at decisions through technical means? I think the example you used last time had to do with scanning a person's skin with the machine so we can detect certain types of cancers. Could you elaborate on that issue?
I'll try. For example, if you have a lot of sudden diseases spreading in a given area, the scientist would say, I don't know what is causing that, and he sets out to investigate. He checks on the water, the trees, the bacteria in the area, and then he checks cross-references that he has related to tropical diseases if it's in the tropics. In other words, it's a careful examination of much of the phenomena surrounding disease. After that, the next phase would be how to control that phenomena. The answer is always, I don't know. Then they set up experiments to determine how to control the spread of that disease. Other experiments are how to treat the disease. And that would be based upon, again, I don't know, to set up experiments to determine the best way to treat the disease. That's what I mean by the scientific method.
Right. Very good. And the issue of computer technology in regards to decision-making processes, the way you describe decision-making processes is essentially as a technical process, correct?
Yes.
And this could be carried over to machine intelligence, is what you've suggested as well.
Yes. I did mention, I think, many times that the machines have no feelings.
Right.
You can simulate feelings in a machine. You can have a lot of there, I'm sure everything will work out. Or right. You can build machines that look like people that have expressions on their face of being sympathetic to what you're saying, but they really don't feel anything. That's simulation.
Yes.
That's why the machines will never take over. They don't have any ambition. They don't want to control people. They don't want to control the world. They just operate continuously.
Yes, exactly. And on the issue of the ability of machines to, quote, think, what is your perception on that? I think you've stated in the past that thinking is a technical process. A lot of people would disagree that they claim free will. But
I understand what they think, but
sure.
Really the word think would meaning making an appropriate decision under certain conditions. In other words, if you live in an apartment house today and it catches fire, if you wet a blanket, wrap it around yourself, and hold yourself down low so the smoke tends to rise, that's an appropriate decision.
Gotcha.
So I would say making appropriate decisions is very difficult, because most people say a building's on fire, oh my God, the building's on fire. That's not an appropriate decision. An action pattern would be to check on the environment, the escape possibilities. Can you go out the window? Is there a balcony to support life there? In other words, what's the next best thing you can do? That's an appropriate decision.
Right. And as far as the definition of intelligence, which I think relates to what we're talking about, how would you define intelligence?
Well, I always mention that an intelligent electrical engineer of 75 years ago couldn't get a job today. So it's a changing condition. It doesn't really have any meaning. They wouldn't use words like intelligent in the future. It has to do with appropriate decision-making for the time. Do you know what I mean?
Yes, I do. And conversely, there's the idea that IQ is a measurement of intelligence. What is your opinion on IQ tests?
An IQ test tells something about the environment people live in.
Right.
If a bunch of Americans, say 20 of them, escaped into the Amazon jungle, say, at the beginning of a nuclear war, and the natives of the jungle want to know how intelligent these people were, they say, what kind of an animal went by here? And they say, went by where? Well, can't you see the grass departed, is spread apart? Doesn't that tell you anything? Oh, yes, it does. How big was the animal? I don't know. Well, look at the prints in the mud.
Right.
Oh, I see. Which way was the animal going? I don't know. You can tell by the broken branches, the direction the branches break in. In other words, you could tell a lot by not actually seeing the animal. So in the Amazon jungle, we would not be very intelligent.
Good point.
Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. You know, people bring up, people define intelligence.
I always ask them what they mean by intelligence.
Sure.
But if you had to list something, you'd say the most appropriate decision under the conditions available.
Sure. And then, of course, people talk about computational ability, and the ultimate extreme is the idiot savant.
Yes.
Can you describe this phenomenon of the savant as you understand it? Because some people would say that they're super intelligent, but I don't know if that's actually true.
No, of course not.
Right.
It's what we call neurotransmitters in the brain. Sometimes it's a whole batch of them in a particular area where you have an exceptional sense of balance due to training, like a tightrope walker. He has many associations related to balance. A mathematician has associations in areas of calculations and things of that sort. So people have different amounts of neurotransmitters in different areas of the brain. An abnormal amount of neurotransmitters in a given area of the brain can make you a savant. But other than that, they can recall events in detail. But that's one ability they have, lacking other abilities due to the fact that they lack neurotransmitters in the given area
right.
of the brain.
Yes, that makes a very good point. Those issues come up
so
a lot.
So I don't use the word smart. I just say that John is a very good navigator. Bill is very good in agriculture. In human relations, he doesn't know how to operate at all. In other words, instead of talking about people being intelligent, talk about the area that they function well in.
Right, good point.
And many people that function well in many areas have had a wider exposure, either through reading, travel, or whatever else.
Yes.
Many people travel, if they go to France or England, if they go to the American Club, it's not much influence in their knowledge. If they live with the natives and the primitives, if they live with people in Italy, live with an Italian family, they'll go to the American Club. If you want to get the feel of different cultures, try to live amongst those people.
Yes, indeed. That's a great point. There was a question, Neil from V Radio brought up a story, and someone emailed me a question. They wanted to hear about how you turn your mother around when you brought in the Asian boy, your friend, and she initially rejected him. Would you describe that story?
Well, at first I used a scientific approach, reason. Let us sit and reason together. Of course, that doesn't work unless a person knows what that means.
Right.
So I did try to reason with her. It had no effect at all. She said, I don't want that kind around. The person that I brought around was Japanese. And my mother said, I don't want you to see those kinds of people. They're different. And I used reason and logic. Like I said, it didn't work. So I said, I've got to make it work, because if I can't change my mother, how can I develop systems for changing human behavior?
Right.
So I told her that I was swimming in the East River, and there was no way to get ashore. There was a high wall, embankment, and I could not get ashore. And Masato worked on a boat, and he threw a life raft to me. This isn't true. My mother said, oh, my God, you mean he saved your life? I said, yes, he did. She said, and I was very rude to him. Yeah, I said, yes, you were. She said, please ask him to come back. I'd like to beg forgiveness. I'm so sorry, I didn't know he saved your life. I said, you never inquired into anything about that. So anyway, she wanted him over for dinner. And when he came over for dinner, she grabbed him and hugged him and kissed him. This is the background of my mother expressing herself.
Right.
And of course, I told the youngster, he was about 17 at the time, I was similar, about 17 or 18, and I told Masato that when he came in the room, my mother would hug him and kiss him and bless him and everything else. At dinner, she was really talking to him. so I walked out of the room. I came back a little later when Masato went to the washroom, and I said to my mother, what do you think? She said, you know, he's just like you and I. I said, but he's a member of the yellow race. You know, I was giving her some of her own feedback.
Right.
She said, what's that got to do? He's a very nice boy. He has a wonderful family in Tokyo. He has a brother that's studying medicine, a sister that's a registered nurse, and he's a very pleasant person. I said, yeah, but he's different. He's Oriental. I give her a line. She's arguing with me now, defending Masato. After about a month's time, she always has her arm around Masato and me and calls him son. Once that was established, I said, Mother, he never saved my life. She said, you little devil, I would have never opened the door. So I don't know what the appropriate method is. The appropriate method is that which affects the change. But then always explain that you told her that story, or I told her that story, to give Masato a chance.
Yes.
You follow me?
Yes,
she was not capable of understanding relevant information.
Right.
In that area.
Yeah, that's a wonderful
story.
Although
my mother was nice to me, she was a racist and a bigot.
Right.
But the Bible says, honor thy father and mother. And all I'm saying is honor any human being worthy of honor.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. And that brings up communication and strategy and, of course, reason, too. There's so many
BS.
Sure.
What works is valid.
Right.
If your system doesn't work, change it.
Yeah.
Try to find other methods of doing it. That's what scientific research is about. You try a system for making a plastic material. If it doesn't work, you try another system. And the more you know in chemistry, physics, mathematics, structures, the more you can bring to a problem. People that are inventive generally are familiar with more than just a simple subject.
Yes. Yes. Great points. There was a question that comes up repeatedly that I think it's worth addressing once again. There seems to be a lot of people that think that what we're doing is merely a technical exercise, building cities and all the things that we talk about technically, but the real issue is cultural. Would you mind describing what you're actually doing to people that don't quite understand, that seem to think that you are an architect, you know, engineer, and you're making, you can make sustainable systems, but that's really not your goal. Your goal is to affect human culture and affect human behavior. Could you mind elaborating on that focus?
And values.
Right, exactly.
Well, that requires some basic information in science. In other words, first you have to learn what science is. And different science is not one thing. It's many different ways of doing things. But the way it's done has to do with the nature of the physical environment you're in. In other words, if you want to build a flying machine, you observe birds. And that's the thing that stimulates it. Because personally, if only I can fly like a bird. And in the old days, people imagined a magic carpet, which people sat on and flew around. But they never talked about what they did in case it rained on the magic carpet. They never talked about if they had to go to the washroom on the magic carpet. But today you have airplanes that have more than the magic carpet. The magic carpet was considered super fantasy at one time. Now our airplanes provide much more than a magic carpet. You have your own computers, your laptop, you have television on your airplanes, you have telephones you can communicate with, you have hot food served. You have washroom. Some airplanes have showers, not all. But anyway, the future will have more facilities. And all, when people say, well, I don't know why everything should depend on science, everything that you have today that I know of, your automobile, your television set, your washing machine, your range, your refrigerators, are all part of technology. I don't know myself of anything politicians can give the world. They haven't increased the agricultural yield. They don't know how to bridge the difference between different cultures. They go to war. That's a simple solution, going to war. It's extremely primitive. They're sort of cannibals in Cadillacs, I would say.
Right.
That most people don't understand what science means. It's the only method that makes contact with the physical world. Whereas religion does not. It has to do with the wishes and ambitions and feelings of people. But I would say that science and technology is everything that you have, your roller skates, your bicycles, your automobiles, your radios. Politicians can't offer anything to extend life. They say, well, aren't you someone of a materialist? Well, what do you think happens when the wind blows and it rains? People get under a tree.
Right.
They're trying to prevent pain and injury.
What the Venus Project is trying to do is find out what are the conditions that are causing aberrant behavior and war and poverty and hunger, and try and change those conditions. You know, the values that we have today go along with the society. They perpetuate this society. So we're violent, and we're competitive, and we're self-centered. And all the other things that people think, you know, greed and bigotry that they think are inborn, a lot of them, they're generated by the society that we live under. So if we designed a new city or a beautiful building, it's not going to solve the problems of war. It's not going to solve the problems of our self-centered culture. Or you know, making laws aren't going to solve the problems.
Right.
We want to change the entire society so we generate a different type of person that is more cooperative, more creative, more constructive, cares about one another and the environment. And that can't be done within the monetary system and then in the price system, we call it also, and within the values that this system generates. So it's not just technology or it's not just buildings that we're interested in, although all that goes along with creating abundance. It's a different type of way of looking at architecture that they don't talk about in today's self-centered society.
Yes, indeed. I couldn't agree more. It's about a transition of cultural values, and the technology and the environment that we hope to create, we hope will reinforce, you know, positive value identifications, social value identifications.
Yes.
I'm glad you guys stated that, because that even though this is a pretty obvious fundamental knowledge for most people that follow all of this work, some people still seem to miss the point a little bit about what we're doing. And as you guys know, we have people out there, you know, suggesting raising money for a city system, and they don't seem to understand that even if we had this system, if we took our culture as it is now, and we drop it in the middle of this new environment, it's not really going to work, is it? Because
Absolutely.
The values are too outdated.
That's why all societies revert to war. They all revert to prisons, police, because they are making laws or signing treaties. Those things never worked for hundreds of years. They do the same thing. And people say to me, can't they see that after hundreds of years? There's a tribe that live up the Amazon River that build rafts the same way they did 1,000 years ago, because there's no stimulus in the environment to change that.
Right. Yes. Great point. Great point. And it also comes back to the idea that some people are still hell-bent on thinking that they're novel in the sense that they have free will. And there was a statement that you made to me where you asked me how much of your thinking is you, or how much of you is your thinking. And I think that's a tremendously good question to pose to everyone out there, because I think if you analyze, we all analyze what we think. Obviously, it's been taught to us one way or another. It becomes very transparent that our processes of thought and analysis are indeed cultural phenomenons, correct?
Yes, the way to check it out is to, if you've got the opportunity to do this, travel a great deal, and you'll notice that in Ireland, people's facial expressions are similar, their dialect is similar, If you go to England, you speak with a Cockney, they're different than one who is raised in a different area. You go in the South and people speak with a Southern accent, Southern expressions, Southern values. When you say I, what are you talking about? You're composite. You're made up of the environment you've been exposed to, the motion pictures, your parents. In other words, sometimes a young lady or a young man lives with parents that are in constant battle, fight with each other, disagree with each other, and they come up with the idea, boy, I'm never getting married. That reflects where they're coming from.
Right.
But if they go next door and the people treat their children very different and they do not argue, they relate well with one another, the child knows that there's another way. But the child brought up under a condition that has never seen another way. It's difficult to even think or imagine another way, although a lot of you people think that you've exceeded your environment. You were brought up in an environment of racism, and you're able to outgrow that. That's not true. It's people that you met of different races, that you related well with, that you've had different experiences than the average person. But it's very hard for normal people to answer questions like, when did you learn to speak? They don't say, it was early in March that I learned to speak. No one knows when they learned to speak. First they said, da, da, ga, ga, blah, blah, blah. And speech is made up of a series of events, such as a person banging their knee, saying, oh. Then they bang their elbows, ah. Then they eat something, if they like it. So language is a series of events expressed in an environment, and over a long period of time, all those sounds become language. No one sat down and said, I've got to invent the method of communication. That's
sure.
Ridiculous.
Right. Well, it goes back to your original point on humans and their ability or lack thereof to reason, where people think that they're novel and they come up with ideas on their own. As I was mentioning earlier in the broadcast, the old Isaac Newton quote, where he, you know, I have accomplished what I have because I've stood on the shoulders of giants. And I think it's a sad, egotistical world out there where everyone wants to be rewarded and have credit, you know, for their patents. And of course, obviously, the monetary system further compounds that ego. Could you talk about ego in this? Because that seems to be another part of this. We have the monetary system, which generates naturally narrow self-interest, essentially an egotistical perspective. But then again, there's other forms of ego that have to do with, you know, chauvinism and things that that are obviously cultural phenomenons. That would obviously be approached in education and schools, right? Things about ego.
Very early. You can wipe all that out before they're even 13 or 14 years old, all be gone.
Wow.
It's very easy to wipe that out through education.
Sure.
You show them films of different cultures expressing themselves in similar ways. You have to show, people say, well, would your system kill individuality? It's really not my system. Would the scientific method destroy individuality? Well, look, if you met an individual, you couldn't relate to them. Think about that.
Sure, sure.
So you can only relate to people that have similar values. You can only like people that have values similar to your own. If they're very different, we tend to say, to look down upon them or so. Or we call them geeks, or we give a name to those people. You know, when you go to war, you call Germans krauts. You don't call them people.
Right.
When you fight the Japanese, they're slanty-eyed bastards. You know, like I said many times, soldiers are conditioned to be killing machines. If they were brought up in a healthy society, it would never occur to them to want to hurt anyone.
That's a terrific point. Terrific point. And unfortunately, in this day and age, we still see the military guys on television perpetuating this idea that what they do with their institution is honorable and for the well-being of the country. And it's still just so depressing how large that establishment very much is, you know.
Yes, Peter, I can only say when I was a kid and I went to the movies, there were only cowboys and Indian pictures.
Right.
And cowboys had two guns, one on each side, and they never sat down and discussed anything. They solved their problems by shooting.
Right.
And that was, we always wanted a gun as a kid, you know, as a problem solver.
Sure. Right. Yes.
So if you're brought up in that kind of movie, where somebody insults your girlfriend and you say, what did you say? And they repeat again, you beat them up. So always the hero beats up the guy that insults his girlfriend. But in the real world, the violent person may beat up the nice guy. It might not work that way.
Sure.
And beating up another person does not change their value system. War does not change the values of people, only experience. And it takes a great deal of experience, and it takes a qualified observer. There are many people that think that they are observing the world as it is. They're observing the world with the value system they were given.
You know, even when they integrated the schools a long time ago, they really didn't deal with the subject. They just sat people of different races in proximity to one another, but they didn't deal with the subject of differences of people. And we still have those same problems today. And you can deal with that very early in schools.
Yes,
that's a great point, Roxanne.
That is. Yeah, that's a terrific point. Well,
one of these days, Peter, you're going to ask me a question I can't answer.
I doubt that. I think you've heard it all. Well, obviously things keep moving forward and changing. Hopefully I can come up with something novel eventually, though I'm sure it will be fed into me one way or another. In fact, I guess the issue really comes down to biosocial pressures, which is that term you use quite a bit.
Yes.
How our decision-making, I mean, would you say it's safe to say that the decisions and actions that people perform are, in fact, consequences of their conditioning? Is that a correct way to term it?
And consequence of their experience in their particular environment that they were reared in.
Now, what do you
have difficulty with that?
Yeah.
Imagine asking an Eskimo, you can have anything you want, what do you want? He doesn't say a bull of a wristwatch.
Right.
He doesn't say, I think I'd like a stainless steel air conditioner. It's outside of his frame of reference. Therefore, no one, can really be an individual. They're composite, made up of all the experiences they've had or didn't have.
Indeed. And a lot of people, when they hear that type of rhetoric, they become emotional because people have a need to feel like they are unique, and they feel like that type of scientific approach takes away their identity, to think that they are, quote, a machine. And how do you counteract people's emotional reactions to ideas
For you, that's an ego problem, one expressing low self-sufficiency.
Right.
A person with a low self-sufficiency is usually a bully.
True.
But if people really understood that and the consequences of that, then they would understand the next step is that people can become anything that they want to. They don't have to think that they're talented in certain areas. They can learn anything if you have teachers that can teach it then.
Yes.
Depending on the environment that they're taught in and who's teaching them and who's able to get to them, then people are able to do so many more things than they think in schools. They think today either they have or they don't, because they don't understand that people are products of the environment and accumulation of their experiences in the books and the movies and the TV and the teachers and their parents, which enable them to do just about anything if the environment was constructive for them.
You know, a lot of people would walk over to a Frenchman and say, stop speaking with a French accent. They can't.
Right.
It's like walking over to a Southerner and say, stop speaking with a Southern accent. The value system is so entrenched, it's not a question of sitting down and saying, let's talk it over. It's understanding where they're coming from and what is necessary to change them. Now, if you know how to do that, you can change most people. Because most people are made a certain way by environment. If you alter the environment, that is, if you know what to do specifically, you can get anyone interested in almost anything, or killing other people that they've never really known. You can take sweet young men out of church and get them to kill if you know how to manipulate the variables.
Today, a lot of the behavior is accidental, though, because they don't look for the conditions in the society that permit people to be serial killers or scientists or any range of behavior. They don't look at it that way. They think either, as I mentioned, they have it or they don't, or they're talented or they're not.
All those words like talented, gifted, are BS words, evolved hundreds of years ago. Our language is so old, really, that we can hardly think with it. We talk at each other rather than to each other,
right,
because we reflect our culture. Scientists do not talk at each other, most of them. They talk about relevant conditions, descriptive systems, and when they don't have a descriptive system, they check another discipline.
Or they hold it in abeyance until they find out.
Right. No, those are great points. The terrific points. Back to my original point, I was thinking about people have a tendency to think that science will eventually prove everything. In other words, it will find the answer to everything. That's obviously a fallacy. Jock, do you see any end to scientific inquiry? That would be impossible, wouldn't it?
No, I could not conceive of any final frontiers, best architecture, best city. It's in a constant state of evolution. All nature has always been in a constant state of evolution. There are no final frontiers.
And back to your point on communication and strategy and manipulation as far as the military and soldiers, I thought it was interesting. I was just reading a book on basically a psychology book, and it was talking about shooting squads, you know, 5 or 6 man firing squads, and what they would do. You know, a long time ago when they would use firing squads to kill people, they would give one person a gun that had a blank bullet, and they would have 5 or 6 people. There was a psychological way of getting people not to feel
using the same thing.
Mm.
Yes. And they would interview these individuals in some of this other psychological research, and they would, each soldier would assume they had the blank bullet, and therefore they were not responsible for killing that person, you know. It's amazing how we've concocted these ways of bypassing our, I guess, our quote responsibility. And I believe in Texas, during the for lethal injection, they actually have 2 people turn keys. So each person has divided their responsibility, so one person doesn't bear the guilt of killing that person. Isn't that fascinating? I thought that was really interesting.
All of that's human aberration.
Oh yes, absolutely.
Kind of like the science of death and destruction.
If there was a field as human behavior, scientists and psychologists and psychiatrists would gang up against all war and gang up against all our social institutions.
Right.
The nearest thing to that today is the sociology departments and universities. They are the closest to coming near human behavior shaped by environment. Psychologists are not there yet. The field of psychology is extremely primitive. No psychologist would try to adjust you to this system, which is completely aberrated.
Right, exactly. That's a terrific point. And the last question I have is a little bit off topic of what we've been discussing thus far, but it was a question about evolution. Someone wanted to know your disposition on adaptation and evolution, and you've mentioned this to me in passing about meaning of certain things or the lack thereof. Can you describe your understanding of the evolutionary process of adaptation?
I don't believe there is adaptation.
Right.
I believe that if an animal is born with horns, it may use those horns in certain ways, different manners. If an animal is born with fangs, they use the fangs. But I don't believe that nature will adjust animals to fit the circumstances. I do believe that animals are born, or say birds, with a slightly longer beak. All the birds have beaks, but they all vary slightly. And if the beak is longer, you can get worms deep in the mud during a drought. So those are the only kind of birds that survive, and they call that adaptation. I would say the structure of the bird and the environment are interrelated, that there's no adaptation at all. When you really think about it, you'll notice that elephants born with a trunk siphon up the water through the trunk or expel the water into their mouths with the trunk. Now, if the animals are born with defense mechanisms, let's just say they're born or they make an adjustment and they camouflage themselves to fit in with the environment. There are some bugs that look very close to the leaves that they dwell in. Now, they think they've made that's an adjustment in nature.
Right.
Actually, the bug that has a leaf pattern, and if the leaves are dark green and it crawls over white sand, it's bothered or annoyed by predators. So the bug keeps crawling around until they come to an area that matches their pattern. They do not develop the pattern to fit in with the area, which is ass backwards. Most of the biologists are not working correctly there.
Okay.
The animal is born every which way. If it happens as a fit, that environment, it'll survive. If its equipment doesn't fit, it will not survive. There's no such thing as adaptation. There are fish that do not have the facilities to exist under given conditions. They die out. But every animal born is slightly different, and that slight difference may fit with environmental circumstances. A lot of people believe that camels have a wide hoof so they won't sink in the sand. That's not true. They have wide hoofs, and they don't sink in the sand.
Right. That's a terrific angle, and it's something that I think a lot of people out there have never really thought about. And basically what you're saying is that we've been dealing with, you know, millions, at least many hundreds of millions of years of evolution in general, and that process is really a process of chance and how it relates to the environment, and whatever works tends to stay, is basically what your point
exactly
is, right?
Exactly that. Yeah. Now, many scientists are not scientific in all areas. They may be scientific in chemistry, scientific in astronomy, or scientific in biology. But other areas, they may be extremely primitive. So don't think of a scientist as one who's scientific. In the future, the words will all be changed.
Sure.
The words that we use commonly are irrelevant today.
Right. Yeah, it's a terrific point. And on that note, we can close out this session. I really appreciate you guys coming back on. And I'm going to talk to you later this week as well. I'll give you guys a call very soon about other issues. But thanks so much. It's good to have you guys back. I hope you're recovering well from your trips and everything else.
Thanks, Peter. We appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity to express these ideas. But people really have to toss them around.
Yes.
What we call think about them.
Yes.
Toss them around a lot. Check it out. Don't accept what I say. If you feel it doesn't fulfill that need, check it out.
Absolutely.
That's the scientific method.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Great. All right. You guys take care.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye.
Thanks. Bye. And that was the Venus Project, everybody. I have 1 minute remaining, and I think I've covered everything that I wanted to cover. And yeah, I love Jacques' point on the evolutionary issue. That one, when he first told me his ideas on that, that really, I had to sit back and think about that, but it makes an incredible amount of sense. There's a lot of reverse meaning happening out there, is what I would call it, which maybe I can elaborate on the next show. But that does it for today, and I'll see you guys next week. And good luck, and I really appreciate all the work everyone's been doing. And please help out poodles as well, if someone out there can. All right, take care.